Welcome back to Reading Bear. Today, we will take a look at some new malicious compliance stories. And if you enjoyed my content, please don't forget to subscribe to my channel and post some bear emojis in the comments. Let's go!
The first story is titled, No offense, honey, but I just don't think you're qualified. Back in my call center days, a frequent issue among our female techs, my team had about 5 to 9 on average out of about 200, was to get someone who would insist on being transferred to a male tech. This happened at least once a week. My friend, Valerie, got a customer who insisted that he speak with a man before even mentioning his problem, saying, "No offense, honey, but I just don't think you're qualified." If a customer ever requested to speak with another technician for whatever reason, the policy was to tell the customer to call back. When told this, the customer demanded to speak with a supervisor. So, he did. He spoke with the only female supervisor, Liz, on the floor, who loved getting these kind of escalations, who asked the customer why specifically he felt the technician who transferred him wasn't qualified to assist him. Apparently, Liz had a habit of letting any female new hires know that if a customer wanted to speak to a supervisor because they demanded a man, they are free to let her know. It gets better. Liz had told me that normally these calls end with a very resigned and defeated customer being transferred back to a different and female tech to resolve this issue. But the customer that had escalated from Valerie refused to believe that another woman would be in any position of authority in our company and demanded to speak with Liz's boss. Liz told the customer that she was the final point of contact he was going to get, and if he didn't like it, he could call the corporate office. The customer assured Liz that he would do so and hung up. A week later, Liz finds out that the customer actually did call corporate to complain. However, unlike tech support, the customer interaction department of the corporate office was mostly women. When the VP of customer service got wind of this guy, she made sure that the few male members of her staff were suddenly unavailable to speak with him, and even spoke with the customer personally. Unfortunately, ignorance often knows no bounds, so the customer continued to call back and harass the staff, using choice language and vague threats, until he finally managed to speak with a man, a representative of the company's legal department, who let the customer know that all calls with him had been recorded, that they consider any future attempt to contact them to be harassment, and he can expect a cease and desist letter in the near future. Liz said it was the first time she had ever had the legal team follow up with anything she had did before. The next story is titled, If You Don't Like It Here, Hand In Your Notice. I handed in my notice. My boss and I have been constantly not seeing eye to eye, especially since working from home. Got to the point today where he said to me, if you don't like it at this company, hand in your notice. Little did he know I had a job offer waiting elsewhere. So once the meeting was over, I sent him my notice. I mean, now I have to tighten my belt until my new job starts, but it's okay, I can live off the high of this moment for weeks. The next story is titled, I run this store, nothing moves without my say so. Alright, bet. 4 years ago, I worked in a store for a large, well-known and well-hated telecom in Canada. I started out as a sales rep, then was quickly promoted to assistant manager because I'm a fast learner. I constantly crushed sales targets and always offered to train staff for new store openings. Joe, the regional manager, seemed to like me and was nice, which I thought was because I'm the only woman in a store with all men. But tenured sales reps warned me that he was always nice to sales reps and rude to managers. One day our store manager, SM, Rick, gets fired for skipping work to watch a hockey game. He was actually seen on TV in the front row stands cheering after calling in, too sick to move, and a few co-workers went out with him afterwards where he drunkenly bragged about calling in sick to see said hockey game. Joe didn't hire a new SM because of cost, so he asked me to run the store but without the title or pay. No problem, I love my job and the staff. I even come in on my days off to make sure the staff are okay, and check on supplies. I'm also the first black ASM in the region in ages, so I felt like I had something to prove. A few months go by, and a customer comes in wanting to open up a small business account with 6 lines. I verify the company is real, credit check, HST number, etc. And process the sale for her. 4 black iPhone 7s, a rose gold iPhone 7 Plus and a BlackBerry. Massive commission for me, even bigger commission for Joe. Joe comes to the store the next day wanting to talk about the sale. I thought I messed up along the way or it got flagged for fraud. Nope. he was pissed that I sold the store's last rose gold iPhone 7 Plus instead of holding onto it because he wanted to take it out of inventory to give it to his daughter. For free. Which is against company policy. And the rose gold iPhone 7 Plus was on back order. I tell him that it's better for us to sell the phone, and I didn't know he wanted to take it out of inventory to give away and it's against company policy anyway. What happens next is this grown ass, 6 feet 5 inches man throws a tantrum. I'm talking fists balled up at the sides, shrieking, "You don't run anything here, this is my store, you're not the store manager, my name is on file as store manager and regional manager, nothing happens in this store without my say so. Nobody breathes unless I say so." I calmly straighten out my uniform and nod, thinking, "You run crap and I just work here, got it. All right, Denzel, you going to learn today." Cue malicious compliance. He leaves and the other staff ask WTF that yelling was about. I say, "Well boys, I don't run crap, I just work here. If you need anything, and I literally mean anything at any time, call Joe." I stopped ordering, scheduling, etc. and did nothing for the next 2 days before my previously scheduled upcoming 4 days off. Day one of my day off and one of the staff call me in a panic, thick like grits, "I noticed there's only one roll of toilet paper left, Dot, can you stop by and order more?" I said, "Nope, sorry, call Joe if you need anything and don't call me on my days off anymore." Click. My staff support me and ring Joe's phone non-stop for those 4 days with the most mundane crap. "Hey Joe, we're out of toilet paper, can you get us some?" "Hi Joe, the windows are dirty, what should I do?" "Yo, Joe, what's the schedule for next week?" "Thick like grits didn't make one." "Yeah, Joe? We're trying to process a bring your own device, COAM, monthly plan, but I don't remember what the dummy IMEI is and I can't continue in the system without it." "What is it?" "Hey Joe, we're out of SIM cards, so can't process any more sales involving phones at all." "Hey Joe, we're on our last few sheets of printing paper so can't print contracts." "Hey Joe, I came in early to set up the new marketing but I noticed there's a light bulb out in one of the fixtures. What do I do?" "Joe? Andy left roast chicken bones and cake in the break area out overnight and now the store is overrun by ants. Please send help." Joe calls and texts me non-stop but I'm off for the next 4 days so I ignore everything, sit at home, bake some cookies, spend time with my boyfriend, now husband, hit another mall and go shopping, get my nails done, get my hair done and relish in the thought of Joe's stupid face stressed TF out at an ant infestation and his stupid eyes bulging out of his head every time my staff call asking for toilet paper. I come in for my next shift, relaxed, fresh silk pressed hair and killer nails and Joe is already waiting for me in the back. Thick like grits, why is the staff calling and asking me ridiculous questions the last few days? Why are we running out of critical supplies that halt sales? Me, "Well Joe, you told me that nothing moves without your say so and that I don't run anything in the store, you do. So, I told them if they need anything, to call you, the person who runs the store." Cue the confused Pikachu look on his face, Not like that, I mean like, just please, please run the store as you see fit. There are ants everywhere and the floors are sticky. And I brought you guys some SIM cards." He scurries out of the store. I graduate from university that year and applied for a role at head office. Joe got upset and said he didn't want to lose me at the store and dangled the thought of making me store manager if I stayed. Oh well, at that point I just wanted out. I aced the interviews and got hired. I've been here ever since, and I never have to interact with Joe. Duck you and the ants, Joe. The next story is titled, "You Don't Need to Be Polite." When I was a teenager, a friend came to visit me for a chat and while she was there my mum came home. My mum had never met this girl before. Introduced them, they made small talk and then my mum asked if my friend wanted something to drink. Friend, "No, thank you, me, you don't need to be polite," meaning, "If you want a drink ask for one." Friend, "Oh, okay." She then looked at my mum and said, "No, piss off." Luckily my mum saw the funny side. I definitely did, I couldn't stop laughing. The next story is titled, "My Boss Wanted Sex Then She Didn't." So, same place, the pawn shop, but this one is a bit more lighthearted than my last and I was just being a little turd but she texted me this morning so I thought I'd share this one. So, the shelves at the pawn shop were old 80s metal pieces of crap that you had to use the power of 8 silver-backed gorillas to put together. My boss, this tiny little redhead who I'll name Stacy, had the strength of 11. I, also a tiny woman, only have the strength of about 4. But this particular shelf we were putting together was really stubborn and we were having a hard time. The shelf beams are thin and have a bunch of holes in the sides where you can attach shelf holders to hold the shelves. So, Stacy is being a beast and holding one side of the shelf with all her strength and I'm attempting to attach the shelf holder so we can get this last or second to last shelf up. After about 5 minutes of her holding the sides of the shelf, I get this sucker in and Stacy is finally able to let go. She's sweating, I'm sweating, we're both panting from exertion. Stacy, just as she's lifting her hands to wipe her forehead, "Hey, I need you to," notices the dents in her hands from the holes on the beams, causing her to look like she has weird bruising and wounds, "Oh, duck me." Me, shocked face, but ever the little crap, begins to saunter forward and seductively runs my hand up her arms and down her back. Stacy, feeling this, turns around and slaps my hands away, "What the duck? I didn't mean to actually try to duck me. Me, I'm sorry. You told me to duck you and I don't want to ignore a direct order. These are very mixed signals." We ended up cracking up for about 10 minutes and getting the shelves up. The next story is titled, "Left the house as requested, only to be taken to the hospital." So this is a story from many years ago. During summer vacations, my mum would always have my brother and I stay with our uncle in another country in order to learn the language and get some culture. We were about 10 and 8 at the time and weren't really fond of visiting the uncle. He was prone to wild outbursts of anger over the smallest things. We've since found out 20 years later, it was BPD. Every year while visiting we would go on a small trip to neighboring cities or towns. Half the time it was relaxed, but the other half was full of yelling and my brother and I getting into trouble for the smallest things, e.g., accidentally dropping a broccoli piece on the ground at dinner. On the last trip to visit our uncle, we went to a small village in the very large and dense woods for a couple of days. My brother and I explored outside, close to the house, and our uncle went with us to a museum. One afternoon in the house, my brother and I were just messing around in our room wrestling and playing pillow fight. Nothing was broken and no one was hurt, but when our uncle found us, he blew his top. We were chewed out and told that if we wanted to behave like animals we need to leave the house, so we did. We didn't know where we were really, so we just walked around in the woods. My brother and I were upset that each year we visit it's the same nonsense, we get yelled at for the smallest things and our uncle tells our mum that we're behaving terribly. We didn't want to go back, and I decided that if we were kicked out, might as well just make it hard for him to find out. My brother and I walked through the woods for hours until it was getting dark, admittedly we were lost, but not really frightened. While walking along, we found a dead tree that we ended up breaking for fun, which was a terrible idea. The tree was full of wasps. We immediately ran upon seeing them, but both my brother and I were stung badly multiple times. I could barely hold back tears, and my younger brother started wailing. Within minutes of him crying, we heard voices and saw a couple police officers running towards us. They said that our uncle has been looking for us and they were called to help find lost kids. They took us back to town and brought us to the hospital to check the stings. There was nothing too serious and we were able to go home with the uncle that day. When my mum found out what happened, she was furious. She couldn't believe that our uncle would just kick us out around dense woods and wait so long to try and find us. Our trip ended up getting cut way short and we went home to our mum. Luckily, we didn't have to spend any more summer vacations with him. I found out later that he was also sneaking money out of my brother and my wallets to pay for things. Our mum gave us this money for our own use, and gave him money separately in order to cover all expenses. Cut to over a decade later, we're on good terms now. My uncle has gotten help for his BPD and we see him at least once a year. The next story is titled, "Boss Wanted Me to Wear Better Clothes." Back when I used to work at a store I'll call Forever 22, I worked with a manager who absolutely hated me. Her and I used to go at each other all the time over random crap. Well, a couple times throughout my time working there she'd comment on my choice of clothes. Usually it was things about how my clothes are too tight for a boy. Or they were too feminine, and eventually I got fed up with it. I read into our dress code and decided to really get under her skin. On her last day working at F22 I wore a dress. But she couldn't say anything since I followed to dress code guidelines perfectly. I made her so dang uncomfortable. My other co-workers, who also disliked her except like two who were her friends, complimented me. I quit shortly after that and now I work in a pharmacy. The next story is titled, My Boss Didn't Listen to Me and Makes a $10,000 Mistake. So I work at an outdoor bar and grill. I work as a busboy but have some responsibilities outside of that. One of the responsibilities is stocking the walk-in freezer when beer shipments come in. The restaurant that I work at is very popular in my town. Which means it takes a very long time to stock the mammoth shipments takes most of a day. 100 to 200 cases of beer. So I got to work on a shipment day and there's more than I thought. I'm taking a lot longer than I usually would. I look up at the sky and the clouds are looking pretty rough. I look at my phone and lo and behold it's gonna thunderstorm. So I take the hand truck and start moving the beer under a canopy. My boss sees this and doesn't like that I'm taking another 30 minutes to move the beer for a second time. She was a police officer for 20 years and as she puts it, I always know best. So she just starts chucking the beer in the freezer way too high with no regard for how it's stacked. I know she is gonna mess up royally and try and explain that that's not how you do it. This is how the following conversation ensued. My memory isn't the best, so this is a generalization. Meet, that's not how you do it. You're stacking them the wrong way and the towers are way too high. Boss, I've been in this game for 3 years, I know what I'm doing. Me, you put me here to do this job and to do it right and I was trained properly. That's the wrong way to do it. Boss, either help me or the door's that way. Points at door. Cue malicious compliance. So I go home for the day because I know it's gonna go wrong and I don't wanna be responsible. Not 30 minutes later I get a call from a coworker furiously screaming at me. Saying need to get back and fix my mistake. So I ride my bike back and walk right to the freezer and see a mess. The entire right wall fell down, ruining around $4,000 worth of beer, $2,000 worth of food, and the entire wall is soaked. They had to close down the restaurant for 2 weeks to fix the freezer from the damage. Beer got under the floor and started mucking up the walls and floor. Moral of the story, listen to your employees. The next story is titled, I'm going to tell the story of how I left my restaurant job. I am a good worker. I show up 5 minutes early to every shift, I stay late when I'm needed, and unlike half of my co-workers at the time, I actually did my job. I was a credit to my workplace, and the GM knew it. After 3 months working there I had already gotten a dollar an hour raise, and a few new uniforms, as a treat. GM's words. This is when crap started going south. Apparently our location was under a vow to become a trainer location, meaning that we would have a member of the training board making a trip from HQ once a week or more to test the employees on their knowledge and their following procedure. This lady was a witch. She showed up and immediately took issue with every single thing she saw. Your name tag was slightly tilted or under your apron. You got written up. You didn't have the right color pants on. Right up. Your shoes laces were even the slightest bit loose. Right up. I, luckily, wasn't written up once, but many of my co-workers got more write-ups in that week than they had gotten their entire time working there. Eventually she started quizzing people, and if she took issue with anything you said you were immediately written up, and forced to retake the relevant training. This could mean that you got the wrong temps for the chicken, or that you stumbled over a word. Now, I may be a good employee, but I say a lot. It's a very bad habit of mine, but it only comes out when the information I'm looking for is habitual and not conscious. So stuff about the uniform I'm game, but if you ask me how long the chicken needs to be steamed for, it might take a few arms for me to pull that info up, cause I know it by pressing the up arrow on the steamer 5 times. My solution? I would just answer in simple terms. No excess language. My goal was to use the minimum amount of speech possible. I was going all Kevin on this bitch. How much mayo do you put in 13 pounds of chicken? 5 pounds, or 1 gallon tub? What dishes need to be cleaned and available at all times? Baking trays and shredder parts. What color shirt do you wear on Tuesday? Blue. It took me a bit to get the info, but I could, and did, pull it all out, with no arms, which I know she would have taken issue with, because she did when Emmanuel did the same. I thought I was in the clear. I thought wrong. I get called over to one of the dining tables, halfway through the lunch rush, surrounded by customers, where my GM and the HQ lady were sitting. I sit down across from them. Me, what do you need? GM, HQ tells me that you were rude to her. Me, I was? HQ, you responded in such short answers, and avoided any conversation with me. Me, I did, because I was afraid you would take problem with something I said, and so I limited the things I said. It looks like I was right. GM, regardless, you'll have to sign this form saying that you were rude to HQ. Me, but I wasn't. HQ, you were. GM, whether or not you were doesn't matter. You have to sign this to continue working. Me, and if I don't sign it? HQ, you don't continue working. Me, wonderful. I guess this means I quit. The HQ then says this, we'll need your hat and all the pieces of your uniform as well. I stood up, took off my company hat, tossed it on the table, and then took off my restaurant branded shirt, and tossed that on the table too. So here I am, a very hairy grown man, standing with my nipples out, ruining the meals of several white women around me. I then take a big stretch, to show off my very Pillsbury Doughboy figure and showing off my hairy armpits, and tell them I'll have the rest of my uniform at the restaurant by the end of the week. I turn, and leave the very lazy kitchen staff to pick up the slack during the middle of lunch rush. Basically, they finally had to do their jobs. But that's not it. I get a call from the GM the next day where she asks me if I knew that the HQ was trying to bluff me. I respond with, I don't want to work in a place where an HQ feels the need to bluff their employees. The assistant GM gave me a glowing review, and I had an easier and better paying job before I even dropped off my shirts, at the end of the week. If you enjoyed the video, please subscribe to the channel and post some bear emojis in the comments.